Welcome to the best video ever. Today, I am with my friend Andrew, aka the Social Duck. Andrew, how are you doing today?
I'm good. Thank you for having me.
Do you know why I have brought you here today?
Yes, we are going to rank some Star Wars villains.
I have brought together about 45 villains from the Star Wars universe, and we're going to be ranking every single one of them. Before we start, I have not included Glupshitos that are just boiled down to bodyguards who are just there to stand around and look cool. You have to have a personality in order to enter. If you're mad that I didn't include your favorite character, you can yell at me in the comments. If you're polite, I'll comment what tier they would belong in. But for now, we're just going to stick with the 45 that I've chosen, and I feel like 45 is already a lot. So we're going to do this. Starting off, we have the newest addition, Dr. Hemlock.
Love Hemlock. Characters that have a very, very gentle but like calculated presence a lot of the time. It makes the moments where they do lose their composure and raise their voice even more intimidating, because you're like, oh wow, shit's getting real now, because this guy never loses his composure. Probably my favorite Hemlock moment is when we follow Omega. We get to see her like quote unquote secretly meeting with Crosshair. Hemlock comes in and is like, yeah, I'm not gonna hurt you, but we know that you've been talking with Crosshair, and we will do anything to him, so get back into your cell. Like, it's a cool reveal of like, yeah, we're not dumb, we know what you've been doing, this is a privilege, obey, or like we will take measures against him. And that's cool.
Next up, we have probably the most iconic character in not just Star Wars, all of fiction, at least in terms of villains, Darth Vader.
I would put him in A tier personally.
If we don't have the same opinion, we're gonna have to meet in the middle. So I personally think Vader's S tier. He's my favorite villain in all of fiction. We're just going to round up. We're just going to put Vader in S tier. I think everyone knows why Darth Vader's a good villain. Everyone likes Darth Vader. I would say that the Disney era, while controversial, has probably given us some of the best Vader moments. Even in a show like Obi-Wan Kenobi, which I think is definitely one of the less loved Disney properties, it gives us some really great moments with Darth Vader, like him interrogating the town, him dueling Reva, which is probably my personal favorite moment for Vader outside of the original trilogy.
I really, really love him in like pretty much everything he does in Rogue One.
Next up, we have Emperor Palpatine. So, obviously, we are including all aspects of the character. So, you included him when you gave me the list. You included him in C tier.
Yeah.
So that's because you're including Rise of Skywalker as well.
If we look at the full picture of the saga, Rise of Skywalker like drastically knocks him down a few pegs for me. It's not even just the fact that they brought him back, which is just awful in the first place in every regard, and probably my least favorite thing they've ever done in Star Wars, but it's also just like his motives in that movie, they're just terribly inconsistent. Not to say that Palpatine has always been like fantastic in like method planning and stuff like that. Like some stuff that he does in the prequels is a bit goofy.
I'm gonna put on my contrarian hat. I think even with Rise handling him so horribly, I do think he's still in character. Like, there are some moments with him in that movie I do like. This scene where he throws Ben Solo into a pit. Worst part of the prequels is that sometimes his plans make no sense. Palpatine is cool when he's on the spot and he thinks of something that immediately gives him the edge, like in The Bad Batch, where he was not planning ahead. He didn't know the clones were going to out him about Kamino. He just improvised on the spot and he decided to turn the Senate against the clones. And that was a really fantastic moment. Palpatine is good when he's just using his brains, not when he's twisting webs of conspiracy. I am still going to put him in S tier. You are completely valid for C tier. We have to meet in the middle, so he would be between A and B. We're going to round up and put him in A tier. Next up, we have Tarkin. I have absolutely nothing to say about this character. I think Tarkin's pretty cool.
Yeah, he's like
you
A
put
tier.
Him in A tier, I put him in B.
He's solid, he's cool, that's about it. So, like, I could go A, B, doesn't really matter.
You said A, so we'll round up to A tier. Also goes with Jabba. He's an iconic character. It's just that he's just like a gang boss, and he's Like, he looks stunning. It's one of the best puppet designs I've ever seen for Star Wars. I just don't find him super interesting. He's just really an obstacle. Next up, General Veers. I included him as a joke, mainly for Veers Watch, who is a really cool Twitter account. Veers is just the first competent Imperial officer who isn't even the main villain of his story. He just comes in, he leads the Hoth attack, he crumbles the Rebel forces, and he lets Vader come in. I like that he's really the only officer Vader respects among his fleet. But really, if you don't have that much of an attachment to the Veers fan base, there's really no reason to like the character. We're gonna meet in the middle. I said A, you said C. Darth Maul, this is pretty easy. You said S tier, I said S tier. He went from a pretty standard Star Wars villain to one of the most complex characters in the franchise. Count Dooku.
I did not care for him, like, at all in the prequels, but I actually mostly really love his Tales of the Jedi shorts, so, like they actually made me interested in his character for once.
Next up is Grievous. You said
Grievous,
S tier, right?
My boy!
Grievous is pretty cool. I would put him in A tier, but we're gonna round up, because you said S tier.
His execution is not the greatest, especially in Clone Wars. They kind of treat him like shit for the most part. I do very much love the one episode where he like storms the Venator and he's like taking on all kinds of clones. He like grabs one of them with his foot and like fucking crushes their windpipe.
One of the first times Obi-Wan is visibly upset.
You'll regret that.
They did him so good in Tales of the Empire. I love his design in general. He's meant to be a coward, like that's very much the point, but that doesn't mean that he's like not also a good warrior.
Next up, Kylo Ren. Both of us are putting on our contrarian hats here. Kylo is going in S tier.
Yeah, I believe Kylo is a very, very interesting character who does have a lot of good character work in the movies, but I think a lot of his backstory and a lot of very interesting introspective like psyche stuff is left to the extended material. I really, really, really like his arc and a lot of Vader's grandson, obviously son of Han and Leia, feeling like trying to push himself deeper into the dark side and feeling the pull to the light and trying to prove himself to Snoke.
Next up is a messy one, Captain Phasma.
I said A tier for this because I find her interesting as fuck, but not the greatest execution, but a lot of great stuff in external media. Her core trait is essentially being a survivor no matter what. Her loyalty is based upon her own survival and what's best for her. She's a very, very selfish character. I very much like what she represents in the story for Finn, the regime of the First Order trying to keep him in line. She's his like personal abuser, trying to say that he's nothing more than a number.
Yeah, I'm gonna put Phasma for me as B tier. I like her extended material. I just think that should have been in the movie. General Hux.
I got a lot to say about Hux. I hate how they treat him in Rise of Skywalker, but before that, I absolutely adore Hux for the most part. I know a lot of people have issues with how he is treated in Last Jedi. I mostly really love it. I really, really adore how ambitious he is as a character. I also really love his relationships with Snoke and Kylo. He's a very down-to-earth, like, practical military dude who kind of scoffs at Kylo's whole charade, you know? But they're both kind of looking up to the same daddy here and looking for his approval. And so it's a really interesting dynamic. I like how they are constantly taking shots at one another and just being very petty and kind of like, again, it's very much like two children after getting all kinds of approval from Snoke, and he's like scoffing and laughing at Kylo essentially with that like shit-eating grin. Rise of Skywalker kind of fucks with this because I do not believe for a second that he would intentionally compromise his own regime like that, at least not with what we are shown.
It could work if in that situation the only person who would suffer at that failure is Kylo. Like, let's say Palpatine explicitly wanted Rey brought to him, and he said, if you fail, you're dead. And Hux sees that and says, okay, if Rey escapes, that means that Kylo is the only person in this situation who is dead. And if he's gone, I'm the leader. Final battle on Exegol would have been way more impactful if it was Hux rather than Pride. Because Pride really only exists as a replacement. He really is just a response to the format that Hux isn't like Tarkin. They basically were like, okay, well, let's just give the fans a Tarkin. Whether you like Hux or not, misses the entire point of Hux's character. You had to write him out of the story, essentially. I would put Hux in C tier. You would put him in A tier, so we're going to meet in the middle. Let's just put Snoke then. So you said Snoke is S tier, right?
This is another one where I wish that more was done with him, but I'm putting him in S tier because I'm biased towards him because I find him super interesting.
I wish that we got one more scene with him in Last Jedi, just one extra scene to display his relationship with Kylo.
Yeah.
But I do think he's okay. I think I'm going to put him in B. I think he's a solid villain, but
I feel like he has such a fantastic design. Absolutely adore his performance. I find his manipulation of Kylo and the whole thing with the First Order to be really, really great. I love the role that he plays in the story for the most part. I hate how they retconned him into being a Palpatine clone. By making it so that Palpatine is the one connected to all this, it essentially means that, Anakin vanquished him for a few years, and then Palpatine came back, turned their son to the dark side, and led to the deaths of Luke, Leia, Han, and Ben. All Palpatine's fault, pretty much.
Knights of Ren, you put them in A here.
Yeah. But they're definitely characters where the execution is embarrassingly botched. If I were to look at them as an objective standpoint where I put aside my own interests, they would be C tier at best. However, their character designs and how interesting they are carry them for me.
The funniest part of them is the visual dictionary where Pablo Hidalgo is trying to insist that the characters were cooler than they really were.
Rope has a fucking flamethrower and he never used it. What are we doing here, guys?
The gun arm one. He looks like Jason Voorhees a little bit, and then part of me was what if he was just playing a Jason-like character where he was just silent and the comedy came from the fact that he just didn't talk and it came from the physical performance. If they got someone like Kane Hodder, who played Jason Voorhees in a lot of the Friday the 13th movies.
You know what I've noticed? I see all your movies, man. And you know what I've really noticed? You're angry.
For me, they're C tier. You put them in A tier, so I guess we're putting them in B tier. General Pride is C tier because I said B, you said F. We talked about Pride already, but he's essentially just meant to replace Hux, which is just really lazy. It's a shame because I love Richard E. Grant. He was amazing in Loki, and it just sucked. And he was also very passionate about Rise of Skywalker as a film. I just wish that he was given a better material to work with. We got Cad Bane, one of my personal favorite Star Wars villains ever. So you put him in B tier, correct?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so I'm putting him in A because I put him in S, so we gotta meet in the middle. Cad Bane is a perfect character to me. I think that even when he was wasted in Book of Boba, he was still in character. He looked amazing. He was given an excellent vocal performance by Corey Burton. He striked a mean silhouette, especially in that first encounter with Cobb Vanth. But I do think that we could have gotten more. Next up, the Pikes. We both hate these characters. F tier. I hate the Pikes so much. They're lame. They are butchered in their live action appearance. They don't look like the Pikes. The Pikes are lean. They have purple eyes in Clone Wars. These are just normal people with fish masks. I love Phil Lamar, but he was wasted as the Pike boss who doesn't even have a name. Gar Saxon, my boy Ray Stevenson, B tier, because you said C tier, I said A tier.
Yeah. I mean, does he have, external material or anything? Because, I feel like people really like him, and he's kind of forgettable to me.
He's in the Son of Dathomir comics, which were meant to be Clone Wars episodes, and he's the one who broke Maul out of Sidious's custody. And there was going to be, the opening was going to be, a really badass, infiltration. But he's great in Clone Wars. He has an amazing duel with Bo in that elevator. And he has my personal favorite costume in all of Star Wars. Moff Gideon.
He's
this is hard.
Fine, I guess. I don't really care for Moff Gideon, especially the more that he went on. He kind of annoys me sometimes. He feels kind of pretentious a lot of the time, and it feels like they want you to treat him as more competent than he actually ends up being. They're constantly like, oh, assume that I know everything, and that he's treated as like this big deal, but I don't feel like he's anywhere near as competent as he should be, and it's kind of embarrassing sometimes.
I like him. I love him in season 1 and 2, and I love that scene of him turning Bo and Din against each other. Issue is, in season 3, they forget that he was a character, and he breaks out of prison off-screen. We never get to see him break out of prison, which would have been cool. He shows up in episode 7 of 8. Issue is then that we never get to see what his plan was, and then we find out in episode 8 that he was making clones of himself. And this is built up for over the course of 3 seasons. The climax is that his clones die off screen, and then we don't find out what they are until afterward.
I'll compare it to Bad Batch because it's somewhat relevant, even though this is far from the exact same thing. But imagine that, imagine before we even knew what the, CX troopers were, that, in the finale, they basically just sneak into Tantus and kill all of them while they're still in their cells. And then afterwards, they're like, oh, this was, that was my ultimate, elite troopers.
We saw them very prominently with CX2 in season 3. And then we got to see all of them in the finale, which was, it was built up to properly. But with Gideon, we just didn't see that. So I would put him in B tier. You said B tier as well, right?
I think I said C. I think I said B actually, yeah.
Okay, so we'll just put him in B. Aliyah Kane, honestly, I think Aliyah Kane.
I kind of forgot her name until right now, but I like her.
I like her, honestly, more than Moff Gideon. I love honestly, Katie O'Brien. So. She's a wonderful, wonderful person. I've met her at Comic-Con. She is an angel. And Aliyah Kane is a really great character. She's honestly more menacing than Gideon. She really doesn't do much, and it's really just the fact that she's manipulative that's really interesting.
Yeah.
And there are really great moments with her, and I hope we see more of her in Ahsoka season 2. Next up's Pre Vizsla. Really like that he is a character of honor. He doesn't want to betray Maul until Maul betrays him. When he loses, he's okay with it. He accepts that he's lost the fight. Admiral Rampart, oh boy.
I love Rampart. Mostly because of his voice. But I do like him a lot as a character. I love Noshir so much. He's been somebody who's been getting thrown into a lot of my favorite stuff recently. I really, really love Rampart's voice, his screen presence, I guess. And I especially like the whole clone plotline. I think those are some of the best Bad Batch episodes, and how he's trying to manipulate his way out of it, and then essentially gets thrown under the bus by the Empire.
And I like that he stays evil. I like that I was a little worried he was gonna get a reluctant redemption arc, but no, he legitimately to the end is evil, and he betrays Nala Se and all the rest of the clones, and he gets a very fitting end where he's blown up just like he blew up Kamino.
You won't be missed.
Oh boy. Okay, we're just gonna speed around. We got 7 Inquisitors to deal with.
Oh boy.
Grand Inquisitor, you said C tier, right?
I might even do D at this point because I fucking hate him in Obi-Wan Kenobi.
People say he was ruined in Obi-Wan. I don't even think he was that good in Rebels.
I don't think he was fantastic in Rebels, but I like him in Rebels from what I remember. And
he was good in Tales of the Jedi. I loved his scene with Barriss. That was the one time I actually liked this character. Fifth Brother's also F tier. He's essentially a completely different character. And here's the thing. I hated him in Rebels. He was not interesting in the slightest, but this is
who told him to snarl like a fucking dog in Obi-Wan?
Seven Sisters also F tier. The only canonical Star Wars character who is a pedophile.
As pretty as you are.
What?
Reva's fine. You gave her a C tier, right?
She's an interesting character in concept, but very, very, very messy, not good execution. And I don't think that she's interesting enough for me to be like, oh, actually, I'm going to give her A tier or S tier because I'm just that interested in her. I might for Knights of Ren or like Hux.
The issue with Reva is that they say she's always doing a reckless job and that she's bad at her job and she's impulsive. But the thing is that Reva, by all accounts, is the only one doing what she's told. She's actually hunting Jedi. And I think if they made it clear that her method was messier and the Inquisitors were still getting shit done, would have been fine. But she's the only one who's actually getting progress, regardless of whether it's messy or not. Now we have the Inquisitors that are actually good. So I liked Trilla. You said B tier. I'm putting A tier. She's the only Inquisitor with a personality. And Ninth Sister's pretty cool. You said B tier as well. Next up is Maruk. You said C. I actually really like Maruk, just for the meme of it. I appreciate how they didn't need to make a twist with his character. He was just a guy. Paul Darnell does a very good job with the physical performance. There's a great scene where Baylan is complimenting Shin.
The gods would not delay them long.
But you will.
Shin, like, nods in acknowledgement. But Maruk does too? And it's funny that he's, like, also taking the compliment that was very clearly for Shin. And he's like, thank you, I'm also doing a good job. And it's like, dude, we were talking about Shin. We weren't complimenting you. Like, I thought that was funny. Next up is Baylan. This is easy. Baylan's A tier. He's probably the best character in Ahsoka. He's...
I would say A tier. Like, I find him to be super, super interesting, but the show doesn't fully follow up on it. But it's all, like, vague speak without any, like, genuine answers. And after a while, like, when the show just keeps going on and he's like, oh, I must find the source of all of this so that we can get limitless power. And it's like, okay, buddy, like...
I'm going to be very critical of Ahsoka Season 2 if they don't give enough time. Like, we need to know what Baylan is hunting immediately. Next up is Shin. I love Shin Hati. You said C tier, right?
I'm sorry. Shin, to me, is a character with limitless potential, but as she stands, she's very nothing. She's kind of a blank slate right now, and she has a lot of... There's a lot of ways that they could go with it. I would love a Wolf Ren type thing, but you gotta, like, she needs to be a character first.
I'm very optimistic, though. I think that whatever they are gonna do with Shin, I'm probably gonna like it. So... meet in the middle, we're gonna go with B tier for Shin. Grand Admiral Thrawn is next.
I feel like this is important. I have not read the Legends Thrawn books, I have not read the canonical Thrawn books. I'm working purely off of Ahsoka and what I remember him from in Rebels. People have called him in Ahsoka, like, a dumb person's idea of what a smart tactical leader is, and that's kind of the vibe I get sometimes, because it kind of, it's another one of those, like, pretentious type things where it feels like they try to make him come across so wise.
Personally, I'm okay with his character in Ahsoka. He was probably the character I was most excited to see show up next to Anakin. And I wasn't really disappointed with how he was portrayed. I know a lot of people were upset, like, why didn't he blow up the base? And I actually really like that he didn't do that. He responded with something out of the ordinary, she would respond back with something unordinary. So if he gave her the most predictable pathway, he would be able to work around that. So just saying she'll go into the temple, just give her the entrance to go in. That way we know exactly what she's doing, because she has no plan, because she thinks that she doesn't need one. So we can plan around that and just have the troopers ambush her. Probably put Thrawn in A, like, skirting the line of S tier. You said C, so we'll put him in D. I love Morgan Elsbeth, and I'm gonna try and put my biases aside, because I love Diana Lee.
No, it's not. Well, no, you don't have to I did not put them aside for my sequel characters.
I love her. I already loved her in Ahsoka, and then after Tales of the Empire, I was like, okay, I love this character now. And I like the idea of how grief can consume someone to the point where you have a superiority complex and realize that if you get revenge, you'll just make up feel the same way that you did in order to give yourself that sense of power and accomplishment. And I love her duel with Ahsoka, both of them. I think that the second one was way better with the Blade of Talzin. And hearing Diana Lee and Asato talk about how, like, there's a language to fighting and how she wanted to show Morgan's personality through her fight scenes was really, really compelling. And you can see the anger in her fighting in the way the choreography is being told in that finale. And it's really, really engaging. And I love just her makeup. I loved finally seeing her Dawn the Night Sister tattoos and getting the Blade of Talzin. I'm probably the biggest Morgan Elsbeth stan. Yeah, so you said C, right?
Yeah, she's just kind of there for me. I mean, I generally like the concept of somebody who, like, is, like, was very, very wronged as a child, and then growing up with, like, a lot of, like, revenge and pettiness, I guess.
Next up is Governor Price. I hate Governor Price.
I don't remember her well enough to really have an opinion on.
I put her in D tier. They write out Thrawn for no reason to have Price be the main villain, and she's the one who killed Kanan, but we have no attachment to Price as a character. Next up, Noshir Dahal's other character, villain, Bode. You haven't
I've not played Survivor, so I'm gonna stay quiet for this one and the next one.
Bode is great, so is Dagon Gera. I love Dagon Gera. He's essentially just beta Kylo Ren, but he's pretty cool. He's a cool High Republic Jedi that went rogue. Bode is obviously way better. I think he's a way more intriguing antagonist. Krennic, we both love Krennic. Krennic's A tier.
I love Krennic.
Krennic is great. Ben Mendelsohn is very energetic in his Rogue One performance. It was nice seeing his cameo in Bad Batch. That was really fun to see.
Oh, yeah. Made me freak out. He's very entertaining. He's very credit hungry. Like, he wants his spot in history, basically.
Dryden Voss, who is a character who got the really short end of the stick when it came to Solo's reshoots, because he was going to be played by an entirely different actor in a lion costume, and the actor could not make it back for the reshoots, so they got Paul Bettany to do two scenes. And I don't think it worked out very well. It feels like Dryden is a character we were supposed to know beforehand. We got Dedra Mira from Andor.
I don't particularly care for Dedra, but I don't really dislike her. I think she's kind of, she kind of reminds me of Krennic in some ways, just in, like, the fact that she's trying to prove herself in that regard, but I don't know. I feel like Krennic's way better in my personal opinion.
I think they're tied for me. Next up we have, I know you're going to have a lot to say on Cyril, but I like Cyril. I think he definitely became less irrelevant as the story went on, but I want to save my judgment for season 2 of Andor when we are going to see how his arc concludes, because we know he is returning.
Because I just do not understand the concept behind his character outside of, like, the first few episodes. I understand that he's meant to be somebody who believes very, very much in order and is very, very devoted to the Empire in that regard. He wants to help out. When we're watching him with his mom with the fucking cereal, I'm like, what are we doing here? And then he starts waiting outside of Deirdre's workplace like a fucking stalker. I find him pretty annoying, like a decent solid idea, and then everything after that is really annoying and baffling to me.
Next up, the Resistance villain. Next up is Savage Opress. I love Savage. Clancy Brown's pretty cool. He's Maul's brother. And lastly, we have the newest addition next to Hemlock, CX2. And I didn't include a lot of the bodyguard characters, like I said in the beginning. Probably would put him in, like, B tier. Maybe A tier, but I think B tier's fine. So, we have officially finished. I appreciate everyone for watching. If you guys disagree with this tier list, feel free to tell us where you would rank it below. I'll probably include a link to the tier list if you guys want to make your own version of it. If I missed any villains, let me know. I'll just say what tier they would belong in. Andrew, thank you again for coming with me. I'll see you guys later.
Goodbye.